Welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. I am your host, Billy. As always, I am here ready and waiting. I am joined by the mighty Caleb Valhalla from WrestleZone. How are you doing?
Hi, Billy. Thanks for having me. Yeah, I'm good. I'm good. Just back from the gym, so I'm still a bit red and sweaty, but how are you doing?
Fine. Not many people ask me, but I'm doing all right. I'm doing fine. Yeah. This is people they'll be listening to this podcast as it goes along, won't notice a difference. But I've got a two week break from doing podcasts because this is like I think number 18 so far, 18 or 19. Jeez. So I think I've earned 2 weeks off. Just not
yeah. Doing I think any so. Recordings. What you're saying is this is the season finale.
For me. Yes.
Yeah, for you. Yeah, okay.
It was my season finale.
Or you're tired out.
And then everyone.
We're going to tire you out today.
But everyone will be like, oh, but there's an episode next week with Harmony Sky. I'm like, I know, but not for me. I wanted you as, I think, I can't remember who contacted each other. I think it was you contacted me, and I ended up kind of cajoling you into doing this. Definitely a guest that I've wanted to get on the podcast since I kind of started this thing. But I think we initially spoke. After I'll do the boring questions, and then we'll speak about me. So, how did you get into pro wrestling?
Oh, for me, I honestly can't remember. I've got an older brother who's like 13 years older than me, who basically, from the moment I was born, just gave me wrestling. So I can't remember a time in my life where I haven't been into wrestling. So he basically brought me up on Hulk Hogan, Ultimate Warrior, Bret Hart, all that kind of good stuff, Legion of Doom. So
that ties in quite nicely. Martin Taylor sent a question in saying, what was your earliest memory of the world of wrestling? So that kind of ties in.
Oh, nicely. Yeah. The earliest, I don't know. I don't know what he showed me, if it was all in chronological order or if it was just, you know, random videos or being so young, it was just, to me, a blur of a few years of a period. So I'd say the earliest kind of things I remember happening is like Hogan versus Warrior blowing my mind as a kid. As a kid, I used to like steal my mom's lipstick and like put the Warrior face paint on my face and run about the house and all that kind of stuff. So that's up there. Probably Shawn Michaels turning on Jannetty. That was pretty mind-blowing for a kid as well. All stuff around about that area. Warrior and Rick Rude with the pose off and all that stuff.
That's all right, but your 1990 kind of time.
Yeah, round about, yeah, late 80s. I mean, probably show me stuff from, you know, when I was like one or two, and it's just ingrained in my brain. I don't really remember the first time. So, it is what it is.
So, would that be your favourites growing up then? Your Hogan, your Warrior, your Legion of Doom, all that big...
Oh, yeah. Dudes. Yeah, all the big colourful characters, face paint, bright colours, the Rockers for that, Warrior, Hogan, Legion of Doom, Demolition. All those kind of guys. The larger-than-life characters were the ones that, you know, as a kid, you're drawn to.
Absolutely. I mean, it's the guys... I mean, for me... Wrestling is all about that, and which actually ties in perfectly where you're currently, well, not currently because there's no shows on, but where you're wrestling is WrestleZone now, which to me is pretty much harking back to that time where it's all big characters and the superhero life, the superhero world of pro wrestling. Just before we go any further, if anyone's watching the video feed, which you should, I think it's a little bit more fun than the podcast feed, I am sporting a Caleb Valhalla t-shirt, which is, I'm sure, available if you go ask him on Twitter. We'll do social media towards the end.
Just DM me and I'll hook people up, but yeah, they're on sale at shows, but obviously I kind of released them a few shows before COVID and that kind of got a bit snickered, but yeah, still got people kind of creeping into my DMs every now and then, so
hopefully just for t-shirts.
So far, yeah.
So the fun story behind this t-shirt is I ordered it from you before COVID, and I was due to collect it at Aberdeen Anarchy. Then, of course, the world ended, and a couple of days before my 30th birthday, it arrived. So I heard there's been some collusion between yourself and my wife that ended up in the t-shirt arriving.
Yeah, I mean you're a good guy for doing everything you've been doing for the Scottish wrestling scene. So what's the, you know, you give a little, you get a little back kind of thing. I thought so.
Absolutely. I mean, I do it just for the fun, but if I get a couple t-shirts along the way, I'm never going to complain. So that goes out to anyone else who wants extra plugging. I can be bought very clearly. So I really enjoyed watching your, for the wrestling I've seen. I've seen you wrestle what, the Rumble, which we'll definitely speak about in a bit.
I thought that might come up, yeah.
Yep, and Avery Anarchy last year. Is that two times I've seen you? Oh. So that was the pre-show last year.
Yeah, that was the four-way on the pre-show. Yeah. And then so, you accosted me after the show, and that's when I kind of put a face to a name as well. So.
Yeah, and I got the picture with yourself and Mark, which there was a couple...
Well, you made me look very handsome. That's fantastic photography. Like, you should take more pictures of me.
Yeah, it's just a shame I was sitting, like, I was standing on, must be standing on a chair or something, because I seemed to be towering over you, but I'm sure that's just camera trickery. Because when, if you saw us, I mean, I'm towering over you now on the screen as well, but I think if we meet in real life properly and you see side by side, I am not that big. So how did you go from watching these larger-than-life heroes, muscle beasts like Ultimate Warrior, to actually becoming a wrestler, or at least going to train?
Yeah, I never really thought of wrestling as like a possibility, really. I'd seen like WrestleZone, well, I hadn't seen any shows, but I'd seen, obviously, being in Aberdeen, the things going around. It wasn't something I really thought there was an avenue into for some reason, even though it was in the same city. But like I'd been, you know, going to the gym for like, at that point, maybe 7-8 years. And I was literally just like a week away from getting married. And Mrs. Valhalla turned to me, looking on her Facebook feed like, oh, Vessel's owner, you know, recruiting for their training academy. Why don't you do it? I was like, I don't know about that. You know, I don't know if I could do that. That sounds like cardio. You know, I'm not good at cardio. I'll pick things up, I'll put them down, and that's me. But yeah, just on a whim, went, why not? You know, she basically gave me the form, filled it in, and the rest is history, really.
So
she complains about, oh, you know, all the time away for training and shows now, but it's her fault. So.
Oh, yeah.
Can't say anything.
She planted the seed there, so take a little bit of responsibility. So is that through? So it's through WrestleZone. I don't know an awful lot about the training academy, which will shock people because I seem to know everything about WrestleZone. But they're very good at keeping their kind of their training kind of guarded, which is actually. Same with their like committee and just everything about WrestleZone seems to be very shrouded in mystery sometimes. So was it through Blue Thunder? Was it Blue Thunder that initially trained you, or was it?
Yeah, he had a good hand in it. Brian Tucker was quite heavily involved at that point as well. Scotty Swift and even Len Ironside coming in quite a bit, which was obviously great for the actual technical wrestling side of things. So yeah, there was a good blend of people kind of with their hand in my development early on, and then, you know, as times went by, obviously there's like been a few other guys in training who kind of spurred me along as well. I was in, I think the class I originally started with. There's only me and Connor Ingalls kind of left from that, so we started about the same time, and then there was like Ryan Riley. Dino Del Monte, Ted O'Keefe, all kind of a bit further advanced than me, who really kind of helped push me on again to like, I want to get as good as those guys and get matches and training with them, and then onwards and upwards to actual show talent kind of thing. So
it's definitely great when you go into an environment like that and you see the previous class and you can see what they're, how they're getting on, their development, it kind of could spur you on. So like I say, you're more strength based, picking up, putting down. How is it changing from a bit more cardio, a bit more running the ropes and what have you? What were your first initial thoughts when you started training?
The ropes hurt. Like, your body tempers to it, but initially, like, I got home, showed my wife my back, and she was just like, you know, the lines from where hitting the rope and everything, and then she was like, that's insane. I was like, yeah, that's real. That is really kind of painful just to get your body accustomed to. And it's same with, like, taking bumps and getting hit in general. Like, your body isn't used to it initially, and over time, you learn to love it. Like, I've been trying to get my wife to forearm me all lockdown, and she's just not keen. And I miss getting forearmed, man. It's just, you know, it's something I miss, the little things like that. But for me, it was a shock to the system as well. Initially, like, my actual gym training took a severe hit the first few months. I felt pretty weak. And again, I accustomed to the workload and balancing wrestling and lifting. And like, in my head, I was like, I need to, like, still focus on the lifting, because I've got these people's safety in my hands in the ring. You know, if I'm lifting someone, I want to be in control and keep people safe. And I've tried to keep that a priority, as well as, like, aesthetics and things like that. But it's been a tough one to get the balance across. And like, my cardio has picked up finally. I think I can, you know, I can go in the ring when I need to. Well, I could. Hopefully I still can. We'll find out tomorrow once I'm back in the training academy. But
I mean, I suppose as well, I mean, because you're, I'd say you're unique for WrestleZone. I'm definitely not slighting anyone, but you're very much more built, a bit more muscular than anyone else in WrestleZone.
Well, thank you.
I know, full compliments here. Everyone else looks great, though. Everyone looks great. But you're quite unique in that you look like what an atypical wrestler would look like, you would expect to see on the telly. So it's important that you are that kind of solid base as well, especially when you've got guys like Connor, who's a lot smaller, who would need that kind of solid, stocky base to do all his high-flying with as well. And I suppose, much like your Goldbergs and that, especially with your start for your first wee bit, you may not need to actually bump. So it's quite handy that you still train yourself to do the pickup and lifting as safely as possible. Speaking of picking up and lifting, so that's that segue, which I almost swore of doing. The Regal Rumble. Because I love this moment. So this was the first time I actually got to see you actually wrestle. Before I'd seen you, it would be as just on videos or a security, which I've seen you manhandling rough. The first time I saw you was when Sterling Oil were banned from ringside, and you were I can't remember why, but you ended up manhandling William Sterling, and from that point onwards, I was like, I want to see this guy wrestle. I want to see him wrestle now, because he looks amazing. But yeah, the Regal Rumble. So, Mr. Malice died that night.
Yeah.
What were your initial thoughts after you cautiously put him over the top rope?
First of all, Malice is crazy. He is a crazy man. At the time, I didn't really think much of it. I was, you know, adrenaline was flowing. I was in the moment. You know, my first Rumble, the second time I'd been, you know, on a show in the ring, you know, in my gear, I was like Caleb Valhalla in that moment. And the fact that I nearly killed him didn't cross my mind, because, you know, it was just a spot, and I moved on, and, you know, went on to, I think it was Thatcher right after that I threw out, and, you know, straight on to him, and then on to Mr. P. Didn't think two thoughts about Malice at that point. Until I came back through the curtain, and the guys were like, oh my God. And then I saw Malice, and I was like, oh my God. His head was like like a cartoon out to here, and then obviously seeing the footage back, and you know, most people watching this have probably seen the footage if you've retweeted it enough and sent it around enough, and it's, yeah, it was a moment. It was a Rumble moment.
The every time that I even like mention your name in this house, because me and my wife went, I'll say Kelly, everyone knows my wife's name at this point, me and Kelly went to the show, and she loves the Rumble, that's her favourite, we'll go to the Rumble, and yeah, every time I mention your name at all, she just goes, oh, Malice, the sound, yeah. It's just, if I have the video, I have the video of it somewhere, I might just try and put a little bit towards the end of this podcast, just so everyone else can see it, and that's your teaser for the end.
I think the hard cam footage of it, I think actually, like, you, when he hits the ground, it actually like shakes.
Yeah. It's one of those GIFs you watch and you see the memes going on and going, GIFs that you can hear the sound, and I'm just like, yes, that's the one. But thankfully, from all accounts, other than a what you say, just head going like that, he was fine. So that's why I can talk about it and lovingly joke about it as well, because by all accounts, Mr. Miles was fine afterwards. But so from that point onwards, you were with Captain Alan Sterling.
Yeah, that's been a ride.
He sent a question in us. It's a very simple one. It's simply, where are you?
he's lost track of me again, has he? He's not sent me to Africa this time. It's
Berlin, Africa.
Oh yeah, Berlin, Africa. There's lots of German-speaking people in Africa, funnily enough. Alan's been no doubt looking for me. Although I thought he was on his ship, so he's probably not looked very hard. I actually don't even know where his ship's docked. So even if I did go to try and look for Alan, I couldn't find him. You know, his ship could be anywhere. And trying to get a straight answer from him where he's docked is worthless. It's no point wasting my breath. I'll see him when he finds me, usually.
So this relationship has been just... I don't want to say relationship. It's partnership. We'll go partnership.
Yeah.
Has been one of my highlights of WrestleZone for the last wee while, mainly just due to the absurdity of Alan Sterling. So when you're coming into the WrestleZone, you're big, scary dude, and then you're paired with the ridiculous Alan. For you, was that kind of like you had to kind of keep up with him? Was that you into the deep end of being a bit more family friendly as well? And how did it come about?
I think being with Alan has really helped me understand the other side, because like me being the straight man for most of it and him being the idiot and the loon has been it's forced me to adopt more of the Gaga, I think, and really embrace that and see what works, because Alan he really knows his stuff, and by all accounts a lot of the guys are saying this is their favorite version of Alan, and I like to think the way we play off each other really does help that, because you can have him be as absurdly stupid, and I am pretty bad for giving him even more outlandish ideas in the hope that he's going to go for it. Like the singing that he did for before the match for Joe Hendry, like I just gave him some songs and I was like, why don't you sing something like this? You know, Joe Hendry likes to sing. And then he went with it. I was just like, this is gold. So he's been great from that point of view. From like, you know, you get into wrestling, and I'm quite into my Japanese wrestling as well as some of your other guys you've had on. So that's very serious, like competition. You know, it's trying to be like fully legit. So to have the other side of the coin and see how our crowds at WrestleZone especially react to more of the ridiculousness has really kind of gave me a better balance, I think.
He's definitely one of those guys, like you're saying, a lot of people find it, this is the best version. I think it's because of that, because he actually has the straight man with him. because when he was mixed martial Allen, which is high up there in my personal favourites, he had Malice. So it was comedy with comedy. And then when he was Lord Allen, it was him and Jeeves. So it's still comedy on comedy. But when you have that guy just in the corner just going, wait, what are you doing? It just adds that little extra bit of just greatness. I love it. And Alan Sterling, for me, is it much like yourself, should be a guy that's just everywhere once the shows restart. But we won't stop talking about Alan too much. I want to speak about your in-ring stuff, because you have had some pretty big matches, even in your very short time as an in-ring wrestler. Even in the last 6 months, there's been nothing, but when you were. Yeah. One of the matches that stands out to me is your match with Andy Wild. I think it was a handicap match, wasn't it? Was it you and Alan against Andy?
Well, yeah, as much as Alan was involved.
So what was it like getting in the ring with someone the calibre of Andy Wild?
That was pretty great. Like, that was, for a debut match, to have the guys trusting me to, you know, debut against someone the caliber of Andy, to me, was like mind blowing. And to know, like, I'm in the ring with Andy Wild, so I'm good. You know, he's going to get me through this, even if, you know, I want to say thingy the bed, but I won't, because he told me about swearing, so no swearing. But, you know, if I made a mess of the bed, you know, he's there. He's, you know, super experienced and just one of the best. So I'm in good hands, as well as having Alan there. I thought, I'll get through this at least, you know. And it went better than I could have expected. There was, you know, a moment early on where we both, like, shoulder tackled, and, you know, the classic bit of I'm not going down and he didn't go down, you know, we're just shoulder tackle, and shoulder tackling Andy Wild was like, oh, okay, that's a big shoulder tackle, he hits hard, okay, this is real, this is legit, let's go. And from there on, we spilled to the outside and he hit me with another shoulder tackle, but this time, like, he caught me off guard a bit and I hit the wooden flooring, and it's the first time I've, you know, taken a bump outside the ring on my first match on a show, and I'm feeling my elbow, and I'm like, oh god, I've messed up my elbow, like 2 minutes into the match, you know. Pushed on, got back in, just working with Andy was a dream. All in all, it couldn't have went any better if I planned it, other than maybe, you know, one or two little things. And the fact that it was in Montrose, you know, my wife was there, some of her, she's a teacher in Montrose, so we had some of the other teachers from the school there. There could have even been some of her pupils in the crowd for all I know. You know, there's friends, there's family, as well as a whole bunch of other people. Like, Montrose seems to get a decent crowd, which, you know, I'm happy about as well, being here and trying to, you know, me and Vago basically being the heads of the postering and advertising in Montrose, feel like we're doing our job well. it was just great.
With possibility of students or colleagues, I'm assuming that the Monday afterwards, everyone was going, don't mess with Mrs. Valhalla, because I just witnessed her husband just batter someone.
If you meet Mrs. Valhalla at any point, you'll realize they're probably more scared of her. You know, she's a strong woman as well, so she's scary enough to them on her own, I think. But yeah, to then possibly have seen me as well, I'm sure they'd maybe think, nah, that's a teacher we're not going to mess with too much.
So speaking of Montrose, we'll go to start of this year, I think it was. I think it was probably the last show before everything just died. Would have been Montrose again, and you were in a Undisputed WrestleZone Championship match. So that's, well, how many months was it? Maybe a year between? It must be just under a year.
Both were February. The Montrose show is typically a February show, so yeah.
So that show was, that match is actually on YouTube as well, if anyone wants to go check out, against Damien. So again, 12 months. You went from the match with Andy, to being in the main event with the title on the line. What were your thoughts on the match, and what were your thoughts coming into it?
I kind of, like, I'd had a serious bit of, you know, a serious wee while of training leading up to this as well, thinking I've got to be main event ready for this match. So, I had, like, Zach Dynamite really, really drilling me in training, and he is one of the top guys in the training academy for, like, pushing some of the guys coming up. So, he was really putting me through my paces, and it got to the point where, like, initially I was quite nervous, thinking main event, up against Damian, Undisputed Championship online, I've got to be, worthy of that spot. And by the time, he put me through all my paces, I kind of thought, no, I'm ready. I'm good to go. Let's do this. And come the day, a few bits. I've never had a match and watched it back and been, completely happy with it. There's always bits and bobs that I'm really annoyed at myself with, or maybe over critiquing, and getting feedback from various people. But overall, like, it couldn't have went much better for where I am. And it. A great learning experience as well for being in the main event, figuring out how to work a main event differently, and working with someone as talented as Damian, and to have him, at the end kind of be like, nah, this guy's kind of got something. It was a great moment. It's just frustrating, obviously, the manner in which, the match ended, but that's apparently nothing I can do about that.
So for those madness. That are unaware, as far as I'm aware, it was Alan popped up on the screen, and he needed to find out where his hat was. That was pretty much the
his captain's shot. Hat.
His captain's hat was missing. So from that point, we'll just kind of finish off the Alan, just about finish off the timeline more recently. Regal Rumble was due to come around, and you would have been in a tag title match. So you weren't the main event, you weren't Undisputed Champion, but you're still in that championship mix right about now. And of course, Alan will be making sure you're in these kind of title matches, because of course he is Tri-County's champion, and I'm sure that he would rather you didn't come after him at all. So obviously all this COVID stuff hit, and that show's just gone, cancelled. When the shows return, are you kind of hoping that's where you kind of start?
Fingers crossed we pick up where we left off. Obviously I'm still quite a little bit bitter about how that went down, so Alan getting me the tag title shot to kind of appease me is hopefully still going ahead, and if not, I'm going to have words with someone. But to have, that match against Connor and Crusher would be great again as well, because they're both great, talented, wrestlers. So that's a match I was looking forward to, regardless of belts. But, to have the belts on the line as well is a nice little bonus. I had one match with Connor previously, which, wasn't as good as it should have been, but I a week or two before that I thought I tore my quad, and it fortunately wasn't torn, it was just a bit of a strain or something. But I watched it back, and there was a few things in the match that annoyed me, and I could tell I wasn't moving as fluid as I usually would be. So to get a chance to do that again with him would be great, and obviously to get some time in the ring with Crusher would be awesome.
So say there's a lot of for us WrestleZone nerds, there's a lot of kind of nice little touches in this kind of that match that was coming up. Of course, it's been well documented. I was due to be in Inverness that day for SWA, but when everything came about, once that got cancelled again, I gave Kelly the choice. She wanted to go to Inverness, so I was going to see wrestling either way. But yeah, when that cancelled, I booked tickets for Regal Rumble, and then pretty much the next day, that got cancelled, so it was a very frustrating day. But that the Wrestle Zone nerd in me quite likes that setup where you've got yourself and Alan. So Alan, for lack of a better term, your mentor. You've got Connor, who of course started training with you in your class. And then you've got Crusher, which I think is probably as close to being as strong as you yourself, I would say, in WrestleZone. He's one of the biggest guys. You could throw about just about anyone. So there's nice little...
We need to find out. That's the thing. Like, get that in the ring. But that'd be great.
So speaking of people that you worked with, the previous Abu Yankee last year, where that stunning picture that I put on Instagram and Twitter came from, you were in the pre-show match, which was a four-way with yourself, Irvin Garrett, Krieger, who was added last minute, and Kaden Garrick.
Yeah.
So, again, a lot of bodies. So, you bar the Rumble itself, you probably would have wrestled that many people in one match, wouldn't think. So, what was that? What was it like, especially at a Regal Rumble show, an Abu Yankee show? What was it like in the Retail Center?
Yeah, I mean, it was pretty full for the pre-show as well. I got a bit surprised how busy the pre-show was, which was great. Again, a good few hundred, probably. So even more nerve-wracking at how well the pre-show was filled out. But originally going into it, it was going to be a triple threat. And we turned up on the day, and I was told Krieger was being added. And, you know, that was like, oh, that's amazing, because, you know, he's one of the guys early on that I was like, he'd be awesome to wrestle against. And here I am, you know, turning up for Abu Yankee, and he's been added to the match, as well as Irvin Garrett, who, you know, got a lot of time for. He's fantastic in the ring as well. I hope he comes back soon. And, you know, Kaden Garrick, just, yes, dream to get to bull horns with him as well. So it was like four guys in that match that, you know, was, for me, you know, people I would have loved to wrestle individually. And yeah, it was, again, a great match from a learning perspective. Very early in my career, again, it's like my second match, if you discount the Rumble, so third match if you include the Rumble. And to have, like, guys backstage, like Pac backstage, actually like watching on the monitor and apparently saying, oh, he's got a good look. I'm like, oh, Pac likes my look. Oh my God. And I'm like, you know, is coming backstage after that and getting, you know, feedback from like Rudo and the Kings of Catch as well was pretty cool. Sharing a locker room with Pac, like I said, all the talented guys in general that were, you know, there that day, and I'm in the locker room with it. And it's like, this is real. This is awesome. This is, you know, what you put all that work in for. So and obviously to win was great. But.
And it wasn't the last time we would see you on the show, of course, as you accompanied Captain Alan. I think that's probably the last time I might mention Alan at this point. I've seemed to mention him a lot. Captain Alan against the undefeated at that point, Abu Yankee, Grado. Again, that's a guy that, I'm assuming you learned quite a lot about timing and a bit of comedy. What was it like working with Grado?
Grado just makes it all seem effortless. And that's not to say he's not putting in effort. He's definitely like out there, you know, busting his ass. But he's definitely he knows his crowds. Same with Alan, and that's why that worked really well. You know, those two guys in there knowing exactly what the crowd's really going to be into. And knowing how to use me, it was great fun. I remember being backstage, just like speaking to him before and after, and just like, this is pretty cool. This is definitely what you signed up for.
It's quite cool that like you've been wrestling for what must be, because after all this COVID stuff as well, be about 2 years ish. A year and a half, really, wrestling. You're still just as starstruck with getting to share a locker room with the likes of Grado and Pac, of course, as well. And if he can point at someone and say they've got a good look, and you see him, That's a pretty good, pretty good feather in the cap for that. We'll go back to your actual influences then, because you said you watch a lot of Japanese wrestling. As it's, again, I've said before in podcasts, it's not something I particularly watch. So who in Japanese wrestling would you say your influences are, or who do you just enjoy watching?
Oh, are we just doing Japan, or are we doing overall everyone?
Anything. Everything.
Okay, well, we'll start off with Japan, because obviously, like the guys like Tanahashi is, he's timeless, it feels. Obviously, there's the top dogs like Naito and Okada doing great stuff. I love watching guys like Ishii and Shibata. Like Ian Skinner was talking about that match where they literally just for 12 minutes batter each other. And it's been a few weeks, so I hope you've watched it by now. But if you haven't, go watch it. It's fantastic. For like my childhood, obviously it was like Hogan and Warrior mostly, because I was, you know, really young. Then like my main guy, my number one like guy that I loved was Mick. Mick Foley was like my idol, and like I was a chubby kid at school, so like he spoke to me on so many levels. That this guy is doing it, I can do things that people don't think I should be able to. He really spoke to me. I was emotionally invested in all his matches. Around about 2000, I was on the edge of my seat every time he had a match.
Oh, Royal Rumble 2000 is probably one of my favourite matches ever. Obviously, Mick and Triple H, I watched it very recently. It went before the Rumble, because I like to watch old Royal Rumbles before I watch the actual live show. That match, it's still holds up. It's still brutal, but it's still enough to be as good as it was now as it was then.
That feud was fantastic.
Incredible. Quite ironic. You think if you look at that match as well, just because of your own physique, you think you'd be more the Triple H guy. it's almost like it's your two your alter egos fighting each other. Your younger chubby self, and then your more ripped self just fighting each other.
Yeah, usually the chubby side wins, because like body dysmorphia is real. I still don't see myself as like a muscular guy, and then I have people tell me, "Oh no, dude, you're huge." And I'm like, "Oh, am I? Like, oh, okay." And then like it's been a big deal at like training as well. The amount of times guys have to remind me, "No, dude, you're jacked." And I'm like, I don't feel it half the time, because I'm still that fat kid in my head, you know.
So some people don't stop being the fat kid, and that's just me all over. All right, so speaking of the being the fat kid, this a terrible segue, but it works for the questions that I've got going on here. We've got a few questions involving pizza. What I do know is during this lockdown time, you have been just going crazy for pizza. Including my 30th birthday video message, including pizza, which thank you very much, by the way, I forgot to say. So we'll try and run through some of these. So we've got Omar Muhammad, who asks, I don't know, a question that seemed to make me just so enraged when I read it, but it might make sense. Do you refer to it as pizza or za?
Oh, just za.
Yeah, that's as soon as I read it, I thought I'm unnecessarily angry about that word.
Oh, I don't know. I'm not a za man. I'll tell you that. I'm classic. Stick to pizza. Give it the respect it deserves.
Exactly. Full name. Capital P, if anything.
Yeah.
So Johnny Reeves has got. Does pineapple go on pizza?
I 100% advocate anyone putting pizza with pineapple. Like Caleb Balhalla is an inclusive man. I will not judge you on anything like what you put on your pizza. Everything can go on pizza, in my opinion.
See, I'm exactly the same. You put whatever you want on pizza. I don't like pineapple. So it's not like a case of pineapple shouldn't go on pizza. I just don't like pineapple. So it's not going on my pizza. I don't like anything that eats you as you eat it. And that's what pineapple does. I find that weird and wrong. So it's just, I don't like the taste of it. But I'm also a guy that ordered, I was so excited that a place in Elgin, it's since closed, you may find out why, let you do a create your own pizza. And I had prawn, tuna, I can't remember, there are two things, but as soon as I said prawn and tuna, Kelly was just like,
Mariner special. That's good. I'm fine with that. Did you get anchovies on it as well? Anchovies would complete your fish. Oh, you're not going all in on the fish.
It was prawn. I had a picture of it somewhere because I got it home and I thought it needs more cheese, so I put more cheese in it. And then I had pickled onion and I thought I've already made this weird enough as it is. Put onion on there as well. God, I had heartburn for days.
I'd made a tragic mistake with a pizza. I think it was early on in the lockdown, where I went to change it to the reduced fat cheese because I'm one of those guys. Sometimes, you know, I'm counting my calories, and also went, like, I was eating 5,000 calories for a good chunk of lockdown to try and like build some mass. And I tried to like limit my fat a little bit because otherwise I'll end up with like 200 grams of fat a day, and I just think that's going to clog my arteries, and I don't want to die young. But I completely ruined this order. Instead of changing it to the reduced fat cheese, I just removed all the cheese off the pizza. And fortunately, it was like a mighty meat or something like that. There was lots of meat on it, so like the kind of grease from the meat kind of covered all the sins of no cheese. But man, it was strange.
It's not the same. No. Not the same without a bit of cheese, is it?
No, I like cheese.
So another pizza question. I've got Mikey Innes. Who's put Biscoff spread with protein powder smeared on a pizza? Discuss.
Oh. I just said that anything can go on a pizza. I gotta say that'll be fine. Like you get dessert pizzas now. You're seeing all those dessert pizzas everywhere. So that could kind of work as a dessert pizza, a high protein dessert pizza. Yeah, almost like a cheesecake.
Oh, I'm now bored. Now you said cheesecake. I wasn't so sure just because of the doughiness, but now you said cheesecake.
Yeah, I mean, pizza is so versatile. You can change the toppings and make it different, you know, all the time. But you can change the base. I mean, you got all those different bases, you know, and even like people using like tortilla wraps as like a low calorie version of a pizza and stuff. So yeah, whatever. We can make it work. I'll try it one day. That's what I'll do. I'll try it. I'll post the results.
Yeah, when I went through my there was a brief Slimming World phase. Well, it was more run up to a wedding. Of course, got all the trim and the kilt. That was a particular favorite, tortilla-based pizzas. Because it tastes bad, but it's supposed to be healthy, so great.
I have a wrestling wedding. It's not like it wasn't a wrestling wedding, but I mean, I've got a wedding related story actually. Do we still have more pizza questions right now?
No, that was the last of the pizza questions. So you can segue.
Okay, I'm gonna segue. So I literally had one of my friends' weddings the same night as a show. So I think it was Inverurie. I think I was facing Bago. And I literally said to the guys, like, I don't know where you have me on the card, but can you try put me earlier, because I've got to get to a wedding like straight after my match. So I had the match with Vago, thoroughly enjoyed it, and then got backstage and I was like, right, I've got to go, guys. Grabbed my bag, threw it over my shoulder, went out to my car. So I'm in my full, like, you know, my tights, I'm topless, I'm going out to my car. I get in the car, I drive all the way to the wedding, get to the wedding in my wrestling gear, grab my kilt out the boot, put over my shoulder, go into like the venue, straight to the toilet, start changing into my kilt, taking my tights off in this little cubicle, getting the kilt on, shirt, everything like that. And then I got to the point where I'm like, oh man, these wrestling boots have got a lot of eyelets to undo, and then tying kilt shoes is a pain. You know what it's like. So I thought, bugger it, I'm just going to go straight into this wedding in my wrestling boots. Half the people already know I've been wrestling tonight anyway, so bugger it. So I went in, and yeah, it was a very strange look, but it worked. So if you're ever stuck, you don't want to wear the brogue shoes, go for some wrestling boots. Why not?
Well, my only slight wrestling-related story is for my own wedding was the photographer was doing the pictures and everything, and afterwards there was a bit of a laugh and a joke going, oh, Billy, you could have taken one of your wrestling belts, because I have several. And then the photographer went, oh, I wish you'd told me, because I had, as soon as you said that, I had an idea. And then as soon as he said that, I could see Kelly's face going, no, you didn't. You had no idea. Shut up. Because that was my initial, when we did the wedding, when we were organising it, I threatened several times going, I want entrance music. And yeah. I want to come down with one of my belts over my shoulder. And I was clearly joking. I wasn't actually going to do it, but I'd said it to the point where I'm fairly certain there would have been a final decision if I had said it one more time. So we went, we're not doing it. No, we're just not doing it anymore. We're just, ain't worth it. Here's the ring back. I can't do this. But yeah, it's. I wish I had entrance music, though. I'm not going to lie. That would have been amazing. We'll go back to the questions. I've got two more. From two people you'll know very well. So we'll start with Blue Thunder. This will obviously be about a match that happened at a gala, I think it was, or some sort of gala. Has Caleb received any extra fire safety training to better understand the pros and cons of fire exits?
I haven't, no. I don't know. Have you seen that clip at all?
Yes, I saw like a fan cam of it. It was like way in the distance, but
yeah, I think that's all we sometimes get at galas. We're lucky enough if we get a little fan cam kind of bit of footage. But yeah, that was a tough one to take. For the people that don't know, it was Haddo House Gala, Haddo House Gala, which was a fantastic venue.
It looks incredible.
Yeah, it's a serious setup. I think we should run shows there after seeing it. But we were brawling outside the ring, and I'm batting him around, and he ends up standing next to the fire escape. I charge at him. He moves. I burst through the fire exit doors. He pulls them closed, and he runs into the ring, and I get counted out. In what most of the guys at WrestleZone refer to as their favourite gala finish. So, yeah, I haven't really received any further training on that. I've been informed by the referee, James Chesser, who's refereeing that match, that, you know, it's allowed, apparently. So I won't fall for that again, hopefully.
There was one show I went to in Inverness that had kind of tried to have a similar finish to it, but the guy would have came back in. I think it was, I can't remember who it was, Jack Jesser was somewhere involved in the match. But same thing happened, burst through the fire exit and the fire door shut. And the place went really quiet, waiting for the count. And all you heard was just a... And the security, someone from the security that was like guarding the balcony... just opened the door and let them back in. So if you need some in the future, get some security around about the fire exit, that'll hopefully sort it.
There was like families, because it was like their fun day or whatever it was, there was families like walking along the path as I burst through these doors, and then I'm banging on this fire exit trying to get back in, and they're just like, what's going on? And it's, if anything, it's a great advertisement for the wrestling that's going on inside the hall. So
the wrestling's on fire. Everyone's good to go. And the last question I've got is, I think it's actually the most questions that I've received for our guests so far. So again, another feather in the cup. I'm going to be fooling. From Scotty Swift, he's put, Caleb, I've only torn my groin once. This happened in a match against yourself. Take that any way you want. With that being said, you want to go halves on a gatecrasher?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, were you not around for gatecrashers? No. Oh, man. There was a place in Aberdeen down the beach called PhD, Pizza Home Delivery. And they did Gatecrasher, which was like the biggest pizza you've ever seen. It was like that squared, you know, it was a yard. Mr. Valhalla informs me it was a yard of pizza. The quality was hit or miss sometimes, but the quantity was vast. I remember back in the day finishing one with two of my friends, but I reckon me and Swift could probably hammer it out, yeah.
So by the sound of it then, I'm thinking Snappy Pizza's Beast. That's probably the kind of...
Yeah, but it was bigger than the Beast, but probably the Beast's the only thing that's, in Aberdeen anyways, comparable. Me and Swift could easily tackle a Beast, I think. That's no problem. That's a snack.
Yeah, well, one spot a Beast for four people. And because we thought, four of us, we'll eat this, no bother. By the time that two people left, so it's me and Kelly, only half of it, not even half of it being, like a third, maybe, between the four of us. So I had a great day. The day after, I didn't have a great day because that was a lot of pizza to eat. So what would be your top, you said anything going to pizza, what would be your top? How did you get back pizza? What were your top flavours? Toppings, not flavours.
Oh, man. Like right now, I'm pretty much only hitting up the ham and mushroom and mascarpone kind of Aldi £3.50 pizzas for a cost-effective kind of method. And I have moved down to like half a pizza a day. So I'm still having pizza every day, but it is only half a pizza because I'm trying to like, you know, drop a little weight before we get back in the ring. So that's up there. That's really good for the price. That's top notch. Because I don't get Papa John's as much, I am quite keen on Papa John's. And I'm kind of missing Pizza Hut, but like in Montrose, there's only like, you know, local takeaway kind of pizzas and there's a Domino's. And I do like all of those pizzas, but I think the novelty of getting something different, especially like a Papa John's, that's a treat to me because it happens like twice a year.
I like an Asda. Give me an Asda Kitty.
They are good. Yeah,
I
haven't had one of those in lockdown because again, there's no Asda in Montrose. But maybe next time I'm through to Arbroath or I'm back up in Aberdeen or something, I'll hit that up. That's a good shout.
Yeah, during this lockdown, because they shut the actual creation bit, they would just make them up in the morning or whatever and put them in the wee grates. Discovered the fajita sizzler, it was called, and it was spicy chicken, jalapenos, green peppers, and red onion. Wow, it was my jam. So you say which ones you'd pick? What so? Just a ham and mushroom right now, what would be your dream? What's your Papa John's order?
Oh, again, I kind of flip back and forth because it's so infrequent. But for me, like, a pizza's not pizza unless, like, there's pepperoni. It is, but if you add pepperoni on it, then it's, like, up there. And then I like some chicken to get some protein in there. Maybe some jalapenos. I kind of like sweet corn on a pizza as well. Sweet corn seems to be a bit of a... And take it or leave it with some people, but like, I think it works really well. Chicken. I don't know. It all depends on my mood, but I am very much looking at like the meat first, and then maybe supplement it with like, you know, some jalapenos or mushroom, red onion.
Yeah, pretty much. The only time I would pick for create your own vegetables or anything like that would be if all the meat was gone. It would actually come into the equation. Sweet corn's another thing, along with pineapple. Don't see the point of it.
No.
It doesn't digest. Don't eat it. Easy. Right. So, with that, we've got our usual question. which I'm sure you've done some prep for, all about what is your favourite dinosaur?
Oh, yeah. My favourite dinosaur is Grimlock, because I love some Transformers. But I wouldn't say I have a favourite species in general. I quite like, I guess, the, what's the one? Was Stegosaurus with all the spikes on the back.
Yeah, okay.
They're pretty cool. That's like a mohawk. But yeah, no, Grimlock's king.
I'm not familiar
with Grimlock. And I'm sure Blue Thunder will pop for it. So.
Yeah. Not familiar with Grimlock. My Transformer knowledge isn't great. The only one I remember being a dinosaur was, must be Dinobots, I'm guessing, because I had not Optimus Prime, Megatron. Megatron one that turned into, it was a purple dinosaur, not Barney, and then turned into to Megatron, which is
cool. Well, Grimlock is the leader of the Dinobots, so. Cool. And then he's a T-Rex, so.
It was actually probably that I had. It was even Megatron at all. It was that. It was probably Grimlock.
Well, there we go. There we go.
There we go. So I do know what it is. Perfect. Great.
Yeah.
So that actually, again, another unusual question we talk about is just cartoons from childhood. Transformers, has that been top tier or?
Yeah. Again, like Transformers was maybe a tiny bit before what I should have picked up on, but my brother again was a big influence with everything I watched. So I was big into that. Biker Mice from Mars, I loved that.
Oh, yeah.
They were awesome. Trying to think what else. Turtles, oh man. So Power Rangers as well.
Of course.
I guess that's not really. I mean, like I was also one of those kids that, because my brother was older, he got me into things like RoboCop, and I loved RoboCop as a kid. He was probably my favorite, like, thing there was. RoboCop, Mortal Kombat. I remember being really sad as a kid because I couldn't go to the cinema and see the second Mortal Kombat movie. And my brother was like, "Oh, I'll phone and speak to the cinema." There probably wasn't even anyone on the other end of the phone because he knew I was too young, far too young to get into it. But you know, he was like, "Oh yeah, no, they say you're too young. Yeah, that sucks."
So before we kind of round off, I think I've kept you for just about an hour, so I don't want to keep you for too much longer, because I'm sure you've got half a pizza to eat and weights to lift. Looking at the future, so before everything went down, or already spoke about your tag team match for Regal Rumble, you're also due to make your debut in Perth for Fair City Wrestling. Is that something you want to do more of once the shows return? Maybe just venture out a little bit more, or are you just quite happy to spend another year developing and
I think like obviously continually developing again. That is like the thing that I'll be doing. I kind of want to get out there a bit more. Like I've got like a one-to-one with Andy FEWA lined up soon. I'd like to maybe get to a few other maybe training schools just randomly. I know Joe Hendry's, after he came up for Summerhill, he took a seminar beforehand and was really impressed with like the level of the trainees up in Aberdeen, because people don't tend to have such, you know, they don't expect it from Aberdeen. You know, what people think, you know, outside of the, you know, Edinburgh and Glasgow, there's nothing. But he came up and was really impressed with what was going on. So he was like, "Oh yeah, you guys should, you know, try and get down at some point, get a car organized." So like, that would be great. Just keep training, you know, keep training at WrestleZone and try and get about, if possible, to other places and start wrestling wherever I can, really. Getting to Fair City would have been awesome. I had some people, you know, who were like, "Oh, that's closer to Aberdeen for us, so we'll definitely come to the Fair City show." Yeah. And just keep getting around, like, just get the name out there, get the face out there. Hopefully people see my face here and see, you know, this is Caleb, and actually hear me instead of just maybe hearing the name on your website.
I do mention Caleb's you about. An awful lot. Yeah, that's,
yeah.
That's a little bit.
I appreciate that.
It could be worrying eventually, but for now it's all good. It's all nice.
Yeah, I hope people don't get sick of hearing about Caleb. You know, but You know, I hope people, you know, just take to the character, take me, get out there as much as I can, really. Like the Fair City match against Massimo would have been great fun, I think, because you know, at WrestleZone, typically I'm stronger than, you know, my opponents thus far. There's been a few where they've been came close, and there's been obviously Andy Wilde, who's a tank as well. So he was you know, able to throw me about like nothing, and it was fantastic. It was like being a kid, and to be able to throw him about, I was like, yes, I've launched this 20 stone lad, and now he's lost weight. I'm like, get me back in the ring with him because he's going to go further next time. But to have a match against Massimo, we've been like, he's a big guy. Let's see what he's got. And again, that hard hitting, hopefully, style would have came through. And you know, maybe I would have had to pull out one or two little things out of the locker that I don't typically have to. Yeah, it's just working different people, working different crowds, working different places would be great. But if nothing of that happens, I thoroughly enjoy what I'm doing at WrestleZone, and really I've got to like live the dream, at least to a very small extent. So everything else is a bonus from here on out. You know, I didn't think this would have been a possibility, you know, about 3 years ago. So here we are, and it's like, this is cool. Just take it for what it is.
Exactly that. I think that's a good attitude to have with it. It's if you don't make it to the big leagues, at least you can pick out positive moments and go, well, I didn't do this, but I did this, and I did this, and I did this. Which is kind of what I've got with this whole project, this SWN stuff. It's like, I'm never going to be a wrestler. I'm very happy never to be a wrestler, but I've been a ring announcer for one night. I was really bad at it, but I was a ring announcer for one night. I've done this podcast. I've spoke to wrestlers like yourself. I've provided a platform for younger wrestlers to maybe put their name out there. Maybe it's not to many people, but at least it's done that. So it's all about finding those positive things that you can look back on and go, well, might not have been absolutely the dream, but I got this done and everything like that.
Yeah.
Before I let you go then, of course, you've got to plug your social media. So where can people find you on the world of the internet?
Yeah, so I've got a gimmick page on Facebook. I've got an Instagram, and I've got a Twitter, and all of them are just Caleb Valhalla. You're not going to find someone else with that name, really. So just go search Caleb Valhalla. You'll find me on all three.
Perfect. Is there anything you want to plug or give a shout out before we wrap up?
No. I mean, you're wearing my T-shirt, so I highly appreciate that. If you're not watching on the video on YouTube, go check it out afterwards. Have a quick look at Billy rocking that T-shirt, and think how good it would look on you.
Felt like I can be your model. Right. Okay. But yeah, thank you for taking part. This has been a really fun chat, and I can't wait for everyone else to check it out.